Welcome. Those of you who are not from Google, welcome to Google. Those of you who are from Google, welcome to 8510. My name is Jeremy. I'm a product manager here at Google, but I'm going to be the least important person you see today. So let me, without any further, let me explain quickly what we're going to do. You're all here to hear about Geek Girl Rising. We're going to hear from the authors, who I'll introduce to you in a second. Then we're going to have a panel of some rising women, and then we'll have a question and answer session. So hopefully you learn something and you'll have a good time while we're here. So without no further ado, let me introduce Heather Cabot and Samantha Walravens, the authors of Geek Girl Rising, to come on up. And we thought we'd start off with a little video explaining what Geek Girl Rising is all about.
I think that women now understand we are not going to get ahead unless we help each other to get ahead.
I have a female manager, and she's the one who handpicks me and advocates for me in being pushed beyond my leadership roles currently.
So many women I know might not be able to work the typical 9-to-5 job, but having this new kind of tech path gives them the opportunity to work from home, to travel, to do everything else they want, to be mothers, but also have a job.
I don't think that Google should be the gatekeeper. Any tech company should be the gatekeeper who gets to sort of, you know, take advantage of the amazing opportunities that technology affords us.
Pipeline Angels exists because there are enough white guy sharks out there, and I'm in the business of creating more women sharks.
I have pitched to groups of all men before, and they don't necessarily get my product. When I pitch to groups of all women, they automatically see it, and they see the value in it, and they see the passion that I have for it, and immediately their offers are, how can I help?
That's that.
Yay.
Okay, so to point out, Samantha and I went to college together, so we've known each other forever. Heather's my new friend. So I want to start with
Samantha. 2 years ago, right?
Just, yeah.
Yeah. Right,
something like that. So I'll start with you, Samantha. So what got you interested in this topic? How did you enter this field?
Yeah, sure. So I like to call myself a first-generation Silicon Valley girl. I worked for PC World magazine in 1995 through 98 as a technology reporter covering the rise of the dot-coms, so Netscape, Microsoft Windows 95, eBay, PayPal, some of the really early tech companies were under my beat. Then I got the internet bug, realized what was really going on in Silicon Valley, the dot-com bug, and I went to work for a software company called Tumbleweed Software, which went public in 1999, and I rode the internet wave up and down. So we went public, everyone was fabulously wealthy on paper, and then within 6 months, we were all really had nothing. So then we were bought, actually we did stay in business, and we were bought by a European company, Axiom, in 2006, so there's somewhat of a happy ending. But I was I made some really good friends during that time, and one of my girlfriends who's been in Silicon Valley, in sales actually, for almost 20 years now, we were having lunch a few years ago, and she said to me, Sam, the sexism in Silicon Valley has gotten so much worse since you've been out of the Valley. She said, it's crazy. I just had my performance review with my manager. She was head of sales for this startup. And she said, even though my sales team had knocked the numbers out of the ballpark, just crushed it, he told me that there's been some feedback in the office about how I am too abrasive and too aggressive and even bossy, and I really need to tone it down a bit. And also, she's this, you know, beautiful woman. He told her she wore too many bracelets and her lipstick was too bright. And she was just absolutely floored, like shocked. And she, needless to say, she did not stay at that company for long. That was not the right fit for her. But she said, you have to write about this, Sam. It's bad. And so I started digging in and researching and discovered, you know, after speaking to many women in tech, working for companies, entrepreneurs, investors, that, you know, most of us have faced some type of either unconscious bias, you know, they call it death by a thousand cuts, where we felt like we're not part of the boys' club, or actually overt sexism or even harassment. And then these stories came up throughout the interviews. What also came up, though, which was more clear to me, was these women wanted to talk about the companies they were building, the technologies they were developing, the companies they were investing in. They were like, yeah, we've all experienced the negatives, but let's talk about the positives. So I reached out to Heather, who at the time was working for Yahoo, and said, hey, Heather, do you want to tell your story? Do you know any women who can tell their stories? And she said, Sam, I'm researching a very similar topic. We need to partner on this. So I'll let Heather tell her side of the story, how we came together in 2013.
So Sam and I met because Sam edited an acclaimed anthology about women in work, and one of my essays was featured in it. And so we met around 2012. And at the time, I was working for Yahoo. I'm a former ABC News correspondent. And I jumped into the digital world in 2007 when I got a really wonderful job that we made up as we went along. It was to cover digital lifestyle, kind of at the dawn of the iPhone and the iPad, the dawn of mobile and the App Store. And my job was to come up with stories that I could tell on television about how the internet was changing our day-to-day lives. And so in doing that work to come up with segments for the Today Show, for example, I was meeting a lot of women entrepreneurs who were starting their own tech companies. And I thought, well, this is really interesting because I've been hearing that there aren't a lot of women in tech, but yet I'm meeting these amazing role models. Why is nobody telling this story? And so in 2010, I started curating a number of interviews. And then Sam reached out to me, and we decided that this was a story that was so big, we needed to cover it on two coasts. Mm-hmm. And so we joined forces, and Geek Girl Rising was born.
So speaking of the women entrepreneurs and the other women you've spoken to, having read the book, and you all will read the book and enjoy it as I have already, the voices of the women are really powerful and clear. And it's interesting to me that the book was kind of structured as a series of, you know, almost short stories about these women. So how did you determine, how did you use that structure? Why did that?
Well, we really wanted to appeal to a mainstream audience. This is a book, and obviously we're speaking to a room full of many women who work in tech, so this book is for you as well. But we really wanted to reach people who love technology, consumers of technology, who don't necessarily either think of themselves as creators of technology, and also maybe don't realize the gender and diversity gap in these companies. And so we really wanted to appeal to people who maybe don't know about the women in tech subculture. So we really wanted to tell compelling stories, and we wanted to curate sort of characters, if you will. We wanted to curate stories of people that would resonate with women out there. So we wanted to take you into their backstory. We wanted to sort of give you every detail about, you know, how they grew up and what are the formative experiences that they had that brought them to the point where they have been able to persist in this male-dominated world and to be successful.
And we also wanted to add to that, we wanted to replace stereotypes with stories, with true stories. You know, if you look at the numbers of women who are studying computer science and engineering over the past 30 years, the number has really dropped. I'm sure you know it's 1985, it was 37% of women, 37% of computer science graduates were women. Today that number is 18%. So the number has gone way down. You think, why has that happened? And part of the reason is stereotypes. So, you know, back in the 80s and 90s, do you remember the Revenge of the Nerds movie? And Weird Science, and today there's the Big Bang Theory. So we have these stereotypes of what it looks like to be working in the tech world, what it means to be a coder or a computer scientist. And these stereotypes are not going to appeal to most young girls today. So we wanted to show, you know, true, you know, pictures. I wish we could have put pictures in the book, but pictures of, you know, real women working in technology as engineers, as developers, as entrepreneurs, and show them that these are women like you and me. These are not, you know, the typical geek guy. Geek girls.
37%. It was actually 100% at one point, right?
Yeah.
So another thing you talk about a lot, related to this is the movement and the sisterhood, right? You had that, mm-hmm. how Kelly Ripa is getting involved. So can you talk a little bit about that aspect of what you're trying to accomplish?
Well, I think, you know, in reporting this book over, you know, more than 5 years and being able to really spread ourselves across the country and kind of peek into what was happening in tech hubs outside of New York and Silicon Valley, we really got a sense of the network that a lot of these women were building. And I feel like the book really sits at this intersection of entrepreneurship and technology. And, you know, if you think of like a Venn diagram, they overlap and the stories overlap. And what we saw is that there are these groups popping up, programs, accelerators, boot camps, conferences, meetups, all kinds of opportunities where women are engaging and helping each other. And it's not a one-time sort of transactional thing. These are relationships that they're building over time because they all are working to the same purpose, which is that they want to have more diversity in this field. And that was just really striking to us.
One of the stories that I just love is Shanna Tellerman, who's the CEO and co-founder of Modsy, which is an interactive 3D immersive environment for decorating your home. And she said that she started her first company when she was in Carnegie Mellon in grad school, and it was a 3D gaming platform. And she sold the company when she was like 25 to Autodesk. And then she went to work for Google Ventures as a venture capitalist. And she said that was the first time she realized how few female founders there were with her company. As an entrepreneur, she was heads down, you know, get the product out, sell the product, build the team, make some money. And she said she realized when as a VC, there were so few women coming to pitch their companies to her. And so she now, with her second company, Modsy, she's gotten together a group of women. She said, you know, if you can't find your tribe, create your own tribe. So she got a bunch of her friends who she's met through the industry, entrepreneurs, other investors, influencers, and she just this past spring, actually 2016, April, said, okay, we're going to Park City, Utah, and we're gonna have a boondoggle 3 days in the sun on the slopes and just bond and talk, and it's not gonna be a professional networking event, it's gonna be, let's have some fun together. And when she was there, one of the other entrepreneurs, Joanna McFarland, who's the founder of Hop Skip Drive, which is like an Uber for kids, Joanna said, well, I really felt guilty because I feel like we should be home with the kids, we should be working on our companies, we shouldn't be here having fun. And then Joanna said, you know, Shanna said, this is what the guys do. They go play golf, they go skiing, they have fun, they have beers after work. You know, this is our girls' club, and this is okay. We're working.
Right, we're working. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. were there any other surprises that came out as you were researching for the book?
I mean, I think the biggest surprise is that the number of stories. And we literally could not fit the number of stories in this book. And we needed to create a digital platform as a way to highlight these women that we were finding. And especially, you know, at a time when you often hear people say, oh, well, you know, I couldn't find a woman for that panel. Or, you know, I mean, it just, you hear that a lot, the whole binders full of women thing, you know. And so we found all of these women. And we continue to find them. And I think that is a really important message for many of the women in this room, which is that you have very compelling, interesting stories. And if we're going to change this problem, if we're going to close the gender gap, the diversity gap, we need you to tell your stories. So when you get an opportunity to write an op-ed, when you get an opportunity to speak, when you get an opportunity, you're invited on a panel, say yes. Because that visibility is going to inspire daughters like ours and other young women who may not consider this as a career, but because of your story, we can change the narrative.
Yeah, the other surprising thing I saw over the course of our 5 years of reporting and researching for the book was that Silicon Valley really is growing up. You know, when I started out in the 90s, I just had my first baby. And I remember being in a cold bathroom, outdoor bathroom, with my Medela pump and style, you know, expressing milk. And people would come to the bathroom door, and they would knock on the door and ask me if everything was okay in there, what's taking so long, and this horrible grinding noise is happening. And, you know, and as I've gone to, you know, from tech companies, from Google to Facebook to Eventbrite to Zillow to all these different companies, you know, there really is an effort being made to offer benefits that accommodate working parents, working families. I mean, now there's like these gorgeous nursing rooms. There's a race for paid leave for women and men and adoptive parents. I'm not saying it's perfect. There's still a long way to go. But I see this effort and this momentum, which is really encouraging.
Well, that's great. So you mentioned the panel. I want to get off the stage and bring the panel up, because that's the important part of
it. Well, we want to thank you so much for the opportunity to be here. This was really special for us. And by the way, the book just came out on Tuesday. So this is really, this sort of caps our week of launching. So we really, being here is very special. So thank you so much for having us.
It's our pleasure to have you.
And I'm going
to
invite our panelists up. And do I need to switch mics? No. Why don't you all come up this way? And actually, I'll move down to the end.
And I'll see you for the Q&A. I'm going to go sit down.
I don't think this is, okay, it is. So one of our findings, do we have an extra? Are these okay? Is this for you?
We got an extra?
Oh, we have an extra. Okay, that's fine. Okay. So one of our findings in this book, one of the things that we were able to do, as I said before, working on two coasts, was that we were really able to get a chance to meet lots of people in the startup world and get a sense of what's happening outside of Silicon Valley and how other parts of the country are doing it differently. So the panelists today kind of represent that theme, and I'm going to introduce all of them. To my left is Tiffany Pham, who's HBS 2012. She's the founder and CEO of Mogul, an award-winning worldwide platform enabling women to connect, share information, and access knowledge from each other. She's a coder. She developed the first version of Mogul, which now reaches 18 million women per week from over 196 countries and more than 30,000 cities worldwide. She was named one of Forbes' 30 Under 30, Business Insider's 30 Most Important Women Under 30, and Elle Magazine's 30 Women Under 30 Who Are Changing the World. Welcome, Tiffany. Thank you so much. Next, we have Kay Koplovitz, who we had the pleasure of interviewing for the book. She's featured in a couple of chapters. She's the co-founder and chairman of Springboard Enterprises. That's a nonprofit accelerator that has fostered venture capital and family office investment in women-led high-growth companies. And to date, listen to this. The 674 companies have raised $7.7 billion, including 14 IPOs. Pretty cool. Kay is also the co-founder and managing partner of the Springboard Growth Capital, which launched in 2016 to invest in alumni companies from the Springboard Enterprise Accelerator. She is the founder of USA Network and the visionary who created the business model for cable networks by introducing the concept of two revenue streams, licensing and advertising, and she was just inducted into the Advertising Hall of Fame. So welcome. Thank you so much. And finally, I told you, this is a rock star panel. Finally, we have Jean Brownhill, founder and CEO of Sweeten, an award-winning website that matches renovators to the best general contractors, providing support from start until project completion. With $500 million of projects in the pipeline, it's been called a renovation game changer. The company is setting, the company brings trust, transparency, and technology to the $300 billion residential renovation industry by setting new standards for contractors and allowing consumers to renovate with confidence. And in 2015, Jean was one of only 11 African-American female entrepreneurs to raise more than $1 million in venture capital. Welcome, Jean. So, I want to get into, you know, how New York kind of differs from Silicon Valley. But first, I would just love for you to start off and give our audience a taste of your entrepreneurial journeys. And so let's start off with Tiffany. What problem does your company solve, and what was the inspiration?
Sure, I'll answer that question. Thank you so much for having me. So what's Mogul solving? Mogul is the largest female millennial platform worldwide, enabling millions of women each week to connect, share information, and access knowledge from each other. We're backed by Hearst and a number of other media companies that really believe that Mogul is the next generation media and technology company for girls and women. And we're globally accessed each day by all 196 countries and 31,000 cities, such that because of our global scale and reach, now even the United Nations has named us their technology partner for advancing gender equality and quality education. So for example, for every dollar that Mogul earns, Mogul through UN Women provides a free education to one woman in need. So together, Mogul and the UN will be providing a free education to over 62 million women worldwide. So the reasons that I started this was because when I was very young, I actually grew up in a family that has been in media for many generations. So my great uncle had run the equivalent of The Economist in Vietnam. My father advised the French government in media, but it was my grandmother that inspired me the most because she had been this incredible woman who had run newspapers across Asia and fought against communist propaganda and had worked to democratize media within Asia. So I always wanted to be like her. She was so incredible. And I grew up in Paris, France, initially, then out of nowhere moved to Plano, Texas, and didn't know how to speak English. Huge culture shock, became very resilient thereafter, a great opportunity to be an entrepreneur very early on, had that characteristic. But I didn't know how to speak English at the time when I was 10 years old in Plano, Texas, so that's when I started watching TV shows and listening to the radio, and started to really understand how powerful media could be for learning and education. And I never forgot that feeling and experience. And then when I was 14, that's actually when my whole life changed, because that was the day when I was 14, that was the year that my grandmother passed away. And the day that she passed away, I made a promise to her that I was going to do everything I could to follow in her footsteps. I was going to dedicate my life towards providing information access to the world like she had. I was going to spend every waking moment thereafter working towards this goal and mission, I told her. So ever since I was 14, that's all I've worked towards. And so then literally by age 16, when I was applying to Yale, I didn't visit college. I applied out of nowhere thinking, please give me a chance. Never seen the college, but if you give me a chance, I know I can visit. I know I can follow in my grandmother's footsteps one day and create this company for women to empower them and enable them, providing information access. And then same thing, age 21, applied to Harvard Business School and said yet again, please give me a chance. I know I can do this one day, following my grandmother's footsteps. And luckily they gave me a chance because thereafter I ended up working with the president of BBC and HBO and CBS. And at CBS was working in media, TV, radio stations, helping to lead strategy, business development initiatives within TV, radio, digital media. But at nights, I then started to take on some side hustles in order to fulfill this promise to my grandmother. So during the day, CBS, at nights, I had two jobs simultaneously. The second job was with the vice mayor of Beijing, co-founding a new venture here in the US that could bridge the cultural gaps between US and China. And then the third job simultaneously was producing feature films and documentaries starring Gerard Butler and Patricia Arquette around different social issues that needed more global awareness. So I became the first producer behind the first North American feature film to ever feature a man with Down syndrome in the lead role. So as to establish new standards in the film industry for new talent and new voices. And so anyways, I had these three jobs. And then out of nowhere one day, I woke up and out of nowhere, my phone had exploded with so many emails and texts out of nowhere, all these letters from all around the world, from young women telling me that they had read about me in that morning, this list by chance I was on, Forbes 30 Under 30, and they were wondering if I could help them by giving them advice on how to get these three jobs as well. So. And so every single day I'd answer these letters and every single day I'd go overboard, of course, because that's me, and I'd write back three-page essays. And then they would write back to me saying that the letter had changed their life, that all of a sudden they had gotten that opportunity they never thought would exist in their society. Then they got that interview, that promotion. And so then that's when I came up with the idea for Mogul. I started to realize, what if we had a platform whereby millions of us could share our ideas and insights and obstacles and challenges, and then from that we become that much better and stronger together. And when I looked around, Reddit was out there, but 98% male millennials at the time. Wikipedia was 91% male as well as an information platform. So what I decided to do was, at the time I'd written a book, Business Strategy, IT Roadmaps. I was teaching other organizations how to better build out IT infrastructure. I thought to myself, I'm teaching others how to better build out IT. Maybe I could teach myself how to code and build this myself. So every single day I'd work with the president of CBS, Vice Mayor Beijing, Gerard Butler, Patricia Arquette. At nights, 3 a.m., I'd clear the kitchen table, teach myself Ruby on Rails. And then after a couple of weeks, built the first iteration of Mogul. And sent it out to the thousands of young girls, and then it exploded to 1 million users in its first week.
That is passion. That right there is passion and solving a problem.
So Kay, you've had a storied career in media, but I love the story that you told me about why you started Springboard. Can you give us kind of what was your aha moment and a little bit about kind of what was happening? It was 2000. Can you tell us kind of what was going on in history at that point and why you were motivated to launch it?
Well, it really goes back. It really goes back to the late 90s when Internet 1.0 was in full swing, and I was still running USA and the Sci-Fi channel, which I also founded. And so I was running that company, and President Clinton asked me to chair the National Women's Business Council, which is to really report to Congress about the progress of women-led companies, and it didn't really float my boat because I like to do something. I'm a builder. I like results. I didn't want to just report. So I just said to him I would do it, but I was going to use a platform to get women into private equity because that's where the big bucks were and where the big businesses would be, and I'm all about big. So I built a multi-billion dollar company, so I'm about big and building. And then I found out, didn't know very much about venture capital, just what I read. I was on the board of Oracle at the time, so I had some friends in Silicon Valley. So I let's find out, are there really women out here who are in technology and life sciences who need to raise capital? Why aren't they raising capital? And what I found out when I interviewed maybe 50 people in the investing sector, they just didn't see them. They just said, well, I mean, we just don't ever see any women. Well, did you ever look for them? No. Do you know any? No. You know, so there was like not a rejection, actually no connection. And I said, well, someone has to change this. Someone has to change the picture on the poster. You know, somebody has to kick the door down. And so somebody was me. So I decided that, well, I got to go out and see if I can do this and see what happens. Let's find out. And so we had some colleagues in Silicon Valley, about six people, who said, sure, we'll see if we can help you. And in 1999, we went out to try to attract applications from women in technology and life sciences, hoping we would find maybe 100 applications and that maybe we could have 10 that we thought were worthy of training to raise capital, because it's a different language. I mean, the language of finance is different than the language of their companies that they were doing. So that's what Springboard really does, trains people to raise venture capital or as other sources of capital too. And wow, we got 350 applications. And I knew right then that this was a vastly underfunded and potentially overperforming marketplace. So what happened? We chose 26 ultimately to come through our first program in 1999. And in January 2000, we presented the first 26 companies at the Oracle Conference Center because I was very focused on having women in the absolutely the best presentation stage, because I do come from media and I really do understand the importance of perception. So I didn't want them in the basement of the local church, you know. So nothing wrong with the local church, just not where I wanted to be. So it was a show, I remember so clearly. It was got up there to introduce the class. And it, to me, it was just showtime. I was just so interested and anxious to see how they would do in front of a group of 300 people that came to hear them who never saw women present this way before. And it was fascinating. What happened? 22 got funded. 22 of 26 got funded, four times the national average. Two women merged their businesses. One woman sold her business, and one wasn't funded. We have never looked back since that point in time. And the market collapsed 60 days later, the tech market collapsed in March of 2000. And I said to my colleagues, we're not getting out. They're going to push us out. They're going to say, last in, first out. You're out of here. You know, you don't have enough. That was just an anomaly. There's not. No, I said, not going to happen. We went on that year, 2000, to Washington, D.C., Northern Virginia, and on to Harvard in Boston, and brought companies. And out of that first-year class, we had five IPOs. First one was 51 Job of China, Kathleen Chen, who presented and is still the COO and the CFO of, you know, a company worth over a couple billion dollars today on the market listed on the NASDAQ. But So we've been doing this for 17 years, now 674. Yes, collectively they've raised over $7.7 billion. You know what's really, really important about all of this? A couple things. 81% of those companies are in business today over 17 years, also four times the national average. Women can knock the ball out of the park, no question. Yes. Why can we do it? We have built an ecosystem of experts and advisors around these entrepreneurs, and that's what it takes. It takes an entire ecosystem. It takes not only investors and entrepreneurs, it takes lawyers, accountants, corporate champions, it takes knowledge experts. The right expert at the right time is priceless to an entrepreneur and really accelerates growth. So that's really what we're really all about. I'm very, very proud. Over 170 companies have had liquidity events and positive liquidity events for their investors. Again, much above the national average. So no question in my mind, this is our time. This is our time, and we work together. We support each other. We're building our own network, our own communities. We're the real deal. And we're going to keep proving it. And the more we support each other, invest in each other, come back and advise each other, that's the real secret. Our alums from each class, the class of 15 advises the class of 16. The class of 10 comes back. They advise the class of 17. It's just building and building and building concentric circles of more experts, more investors, more knowledgeable people. You know, the world is ours to grab. This is a time to go, full bore out. I built a company that was sold at really undervalued because it was among friends for $4.5 billion. I think $7.7 billion is better and bigger and going to have longer lasting value in the marketplace with all the changes in the media business. I'm confident that all of our companies in biotech and healthcare IT and cybersecurity and SaaS models and fintech and fashion tech and all these different areas that we're in, bigger impact on the world than we ever had, which I'm very proud of USA Network. So anyway.
No, it's wonderful. And it means please applaud. Springboard, and we get into this in the book a little bit, but Springboard really paved the way for what we're seeing now, these accelerators and even angel groups, all women getting involved in investing because they could.
That's an interesting point. When we started off, less than 1% of the angel investors, according to research that I've said, were women in 2000 when we started out. Mm-hmm. Today, almost 30%.
Yes. Yes.
I mean, this is really providing early seed capital for women-led, for companies, but many of them women-led companies.
And one of those angel investors, who we also profile in the book, Joanne Wilson, invested in Jean's company, Sweeten. So why don't you talk a little bit about that and the genesis for your company as well?
Yeah. Joanne was actually the first check in my company, and she wrote it on basically first meeting me. She's amazing. For any of you who don't know who she is, Joanne Wilson is a really big supporter of women founders. So I'm Jean Brownhill, and I'm the founder and CEO of a company called Sweeten.com. We are renovation matchmakers. We help homeowners and small business owners find great general contractors from our curated list of GCs. And then once the match is made, we actually follow your project from the start all the way to the finish to make sure that's done on time and budget and that you're happy. You get to review that general contractor at the end of the project, and that rating then basically impacts his deal flow in his next project. So it's kind of like, a very extended Uber ride. You can think of it that way. Originally, I'm an architect by training, so I was in this role for a long time helping people with their renovation projects. However, I was doing it serving, very high-end projects, and I was really feeling disconnected from that consumer. I come from a place without architects. I come from, a family that had very little means, so much so that when I was applying for college, my guidance counselor was like, oh, you're good at math and science. Now, at math, science, and art. And of course, they didn't know this because I'm dyslexic and I had a hard time reading, but he skipped over that and was like, you should go to architecture school. That's literally how I discovered architecture as a profession. And my mom at the time found this, you know, they had these books, College for Dummies books, for those of you who are old enough to remember those black and yellow books. And she's like, oh, Cooper Union is a free architecture school. That's where you should go because we have no money for you to go to college. And of course, at the time, I did not realize that what she was saying was like, you know, Cooper's like harder to get into than West Point. So somehow I was able to get in. A very similar story. I was like, please let me in. I know I can do well here. I got in, graduated from architecture school, worked as a traditional architect, as I said, for a long time. And it was actually around September 11th where I really had this kind of very early in my career, but very impactful experience where I watched the two buildings come down as I was like trapped on the Q train on the Manhattan Bridge. So I'm sitting there, I see the first plane hit, or second plane hit. And I was like, oh my God, I just spent all this time learning how to put up buildings. I never even imagined that anybody would want to take them down. Like, I don't understand the world at all. Like, at all. So I went down this path of like reading about, I was like, I'm gonna understand money and power. Which like sounds so naive, but I literally started reading every book I could about money and power. I read like books on, I figured money would be easier, so I started reading books on money first. I started learning about like marketplaces and marketplace dynamics. So here I was, I'm an architect by training, I'm learning about economy, like economics, but I really had this passion for like, how can I help regular people? So all of those things kind of combined in this flurry of ideas of like, oh, I'll build a website. And again, like a traditional architect, did not have any background in this. And you know, I could tell you the very short story, like, oh, I started a website and it was just very successful. Of course, that's not the real story. There was lots of iterations before I got to this point. There were two other companies that did not succeed, but always trying to solve that same problem of how can I get, you know, like my mom or your mom or regular people, how can I get them a space that truly is for them, that is custom made, that they just feel so excited to walk into. And we've done that through bringing trust and transparency and finding them great general contractors to build those spaces. So that's kind of how I got here.
What's really, really interesting about these two stories is on-the-job training is so important, and you cannot really understand what it's like to be an entrepreneur until you actually do it. It's really iteration every single day. It's yes. Learning and applying it every single day. And that's just kind of interesting listening to these.
Yeah, things. Yeah, absolutely. I want to talk a little bit about what it's like to be in the startup world in New York and how it is different from Silicon Valley. Tech companies founded by women grew tenfold in New York City between 2003 and 2014 and raised $3 billion in capital, according to a report by Endeavor. So there's a vibrant scene here. You're all immersed in it. I'm curious, what do you think is different about New York? What can other parts of the country learn from New York in terms of how women are succeeding here? So those are my two questions for the panel. Whoever wants to take it first.
Well, I'll take it first because we have companies in 39 states across the United States and on six continents, so I have a lot of comparisons.
Yeah.
But I would say New York is different because there are many different industries here in New York. So I've started Fashion Tech Lab because the fashion industry and the retail business was not keeping up with the technology, especially when the smartphone came out. And we realized that they're going to be dragged down. And if anybody read the article in the Wall Street Journal today on the front page about J. Crew, you'll see that they are saying, we didn't understand the revolution that we didn't pay enough attention to it, and you know we're gonna suffer now for that consequence. And so the retail business, the publishing, the media business, these are businesses, the advertising business, there are lots of businesses. Well, there's a financial business also here, and others, but in the arts, but they're prevalent here. They're not prevalent in Silicon Valley. They do not exist in Silicon Valley, really. And so that's a bit, the technology is great out of Silicon Valley, but They don't have these other businesses, and there are many more women in these other businesses and in social media and things like that, and that women really are dominant in. And I think from my perspective and just looking at what is happening, we just have women who are experts in so many different kinds of businesses that are affected by technology, that are being changed by technology, but it's a fundamental knowledge about different businesses than the pure technology businesses alone. So I think that that's a huge difference here, and why it's more amenable. And in Boston is in particular vibrant for women, and is particularly in the life sciences, very robust for women. So I think that, there are differences.
Completely agree. In New York, the diversity is what enables us to thrive at Mogul. So in terms of diversity, it drives us to succeed because a number of the people here in New York, of course, are aligned with our mission, believing in diversity in the way that we drive it through job opportunity and education. So that already is a huge win, being here in New York. But there's other ways it helps us thrive, such as the talent here in New York. There's such incredible minds and perspectives that enable us to draw such an amazing team from so many different backgrounds. And that's probably why in the last 3-4 years of Mogul, we haven't had ever a single person resign, because we've drawn from such a wide variety of backgrounds that we have an amazing, authentic culture at Mogul from so many different perspectives. It's like the UN practically inside Mogul. So everyone loves it there as a result. And then in terms of the way we monetize too, we're greatly supported by the infrastructure that is in New York because of the variety of industries. So for example, Mogul monetizes in 3 main ways. One of them is a division called Mogul at Work, and that's where we work with the heads of HR and diversity and inclusion across industries to enable them to recruit talent on the platform. So as a result, all the diversity and inclusion heads, all of the heads of HR, many of them are either in New York or our counterparts are stationed in New York. So it's really powerful to be here. And then another division is called Mogul Studios, and that's where we work with the heads of marketing and the heads of agencies, and they're all here in New York, and that's where we enable them to create content targeting female millennials and enabling them to impact their communication towards female millennials. And then finally, there's Mogul Learning, which is where we're commissioned by the Department of Education in New York, New York Department of Education, in other words, to create webinar trainings and courses, over 1,200 modules, to provide to hundreds of thousands of teachers and employees to provide to their workplaces and schools. So all across the board, every part of us, we succeed because of New York.
Thanks. Jean, you want to talk about your experience?
Yeah, no, I was just going to add, I definitely, and this is a broad generalization, but I do feel like on the West Coast, as you were saying, it often feels like they're looking for a problem for the technology that they've already built to solve, right? Like, what could we put this on? Mm-hmm. And in New York, maybe it's just like, maybe because they are mostly companies that are coming from industry experts, or you've already been in a vertical or a business, we are all about just finding a technology that will help us solve the problems that we have. Right? When we started this company, it looked like a real website, but it was really just a form where homeowners and small business owners could come and give us some information about the project that they were doing. And it's funny that we're here at Google now, because I should maybe like give them some shares of our company, because most of the company was run in Gmail, in Google Forms, in once they put that form in on the website, it totally went into an email inbox and Google Forms and Google Excel, or not Excel, spreadsheets. Like, we used the technology to solve the problems that, like, the real life problems that our homeowners and small business owners and general contractors were having. And I think, I think about Steve Blank when he says, like, get out of the building. I think in New York City, it's just easier to get out of the building, because you have to get out of the building. You have to interface with people. You have to be on the street. You have to be in the subway. We don't jump in our car and like go home. Like, we're always out of the building. So I think that's a really real difference.
Yeah, that's a really interesting point. Time is running tight, and I'm so sorry because this is such a great panel. So I just want to wrap it up with your advice for aspiring entrepreneurs who are here today. What's your one biggest piece of advice that maybe you wish you knew when you started or that you want to impart upon this crowd?
Go sleep now.
No, that's not my advice. Go, sorry.
Biggest advice is, in terms of technology, if you have an idea, just get started on it right away. Don't wait until it's perfect. When I first started, remember I was a junior coder. My first website was so ugly, but it was so basic, and yet it worked, and it, eventually spread to millions. So at the very beginning, just rapidly prototype, and you'll know over time that you'll be able to iterate towards perfection over the years, over the time. And then secondly, a big reason for success in New York, which I didn't mention and I should have, is because of collaboration and so many incredible people being here and being willing to help and support. So that's my second piece of advice, is that if you respect anyone in the industry, if you admire them, just reach out to them, email them. If they don't respond, it's okay, they're not going to remember. Reach out to them again and ask in a way that they can't decline. If you can have a 5-minute call or a 15-minute tea, and through that, establish that friendship that will turn one day into a collaboration, that will turn into a long-term partnership one day. And that's what we've done time and again at Mogul, and I think that's another big reason for success.
I know that everybody's not cut out to be an entrepreneur. It is a sort of a calling that we're all crazy people. And we're not all really crazy, but we're crazy to do something that we want to do and other people think is crazy. But one of the things I think is really important is if you just want to, you have to keep learning every single day, whether you work in a big corporation. Google is a big, huge corporation, but a lot of latitude to do different things. Really take risks. Take some risks inside the corporation, or if you have a great idea that you want to pursue, take the risk to do it, because you can't move forward without taking a risk in your career. If you're an entrepreneur, you certainly can't do it without being a risk taker of some sort. Every risk doesn't mean a destruction of something, or something goes wrong and it doesn't work out. We have the most forgiving culture, I think, for trying, and even if it fails, that failure is not your goal, but even if it does, people are understanding, what did you learn and what can you apply to the next time you do something or to the continuing on? And I think that that is really part of the innovative culture that we are all living in today, and that is going to be more and more prevalent as you go forward. So I would just say, and if you do have sort of a inkling, feeling that you are cut out for being an entrepreneur, I think it's great to go to work first for a small company who is in a startup situation to learn and see what the challenges really are, and are they for you? You can learn that without having to be the founder yourself. Mm-hmm. You can go into a firm with 12 employees and see what it's really like, because you have to learn to do everything there almost, because you have to do what's required at the moment. And you'll find out, And if it's for you, great. You might get the great idea. For me, using satellites to deliver television was a passion when I wrote my master's thesis in 1968, when I was only 4 years old. I had lunch today with two guys from Wisconsin where I went to school, and neither of them was born when I graduated from the University of Wisconsin. So anyway, I think there's a class for women over 70. You know what I mean? I'm it. So, I just think that there are a lot of ways to find out if it's really for you, and you don't have to be the founder of the minute you get an idea. You can go out and learn about it, and you can also apply it to where you work, because being innovative, taking risks in your own job, raising your hand for something that you don't know yet how to do, you don't have to know the answers. You have to be willing to try. That's my advice.
Yeah. Love that. I love that.
I think it's really interesting that you say that. I was just saying, my business card doesn't say this, but I was thinking about putting CEO and janitor. Because you really do everything from the beginning of the day till the very end of the day. So my words of advice would be, I guess, twofold. One, I think the most important thing is just to not give up. If you really do feel like you have a passion and you want to be an entrepreneur, all of this advice is absolutely, I think, the right direction, learning, figuring out, you know, testing if it is for you. But if you do come to that decision, just don't give up. And I know that sounds like really kind of simple advice, but literally there have been so many moments where I have wanted to be like, you know, forget it. And like basically every single day at some point in the day as an entrepreneur, you're going to have the very highest high you've ever had and the lowest low, and they'll be like 2 hours apart. So you have to be willing to stick it out. And then the next piece of advice I would just say is to try to, and this again maybe sounds a little simple, but you know, you may see me up here smiling a lot. I do smile a lot. I try to remember that this is a choice and that it's enjoyable, right? That it's really fun to be an entrepreneur, even though it's really tough. And I think sometimes when, you know, I see entrepreneurs and they just talk about the pain or they just, you know, it seems to oscillate. In the press, they'll be like, it's so fantastic, it's so great. And then when we all get together for drinks, it's like, I hate everybody, I want to kill everybody. So you really need to stay positive. And maybe that's my last piece of advice is, don't believe too much about what you read about being an entrepreneur in the press. Go and experience it firsthand. Go get a job inside of a startup. People will give you a very linear path in the press, and they will give you a very positive path in the press, and that's just not the case. It's, like I said, very highest highs, very lowest lows, usually on the same day within 2 hours.
Thank you. And thank you so much for sharing your time. We're going to take some questions. We're going to invite Sam back up. And I just want to let you know that this is actually being recorded. And so because it's being recorded, we want to make sure we get good audio from your questions. So if you have questions, please go to the microphones that are on both sides of the auditorium, because we want to have the audio from your questions. So questions.
Don't be shy. Yeah.
I see someone going. I'm going to move my chair.
Are you able to see them?
Hello, everyone.
Tell us your name, too.
Hi, my name is Edwina Kulego. I work in international business development for a fashion trade show. And I wanted to first thank you for your advice and for sharing with all of us. It was very informative. And I wanted to ask Jean, you mentioned that you read a lot of books on money and power. Could you give some recommendations on a few books that we could all pick up?
Oh, boy. What are the ones that time that were most impactful? You know, I read this really great book on Warren Buffett. It's like 900 pages on Warren Buffett by Roger Lowenstein. That was a really interesting one. You're put me on the spot here. Sorry. Let me try to think about it and I'll get back to you which ones. Right now I'm reading a really interesting book called Reinventing Organizations, all about like holacracy and self-managed teams. That's super interesting but very topical for me right now. Let me think about it.
Excellent. Thank you. I'll follow up for sure.
Yeah, for sure.
Thanks. Thank you. Anyone else? Thank you. Yeah, well, yes, because they're recording the audio.
Hi, I'm Claire Cowart. Kay, you might remember me from back in the day. We were both in the cable satellite industry together. I run a consulting firm called Ubinker, Out of Box Thinkers, and we mostly work with startups. And I also teach entrepreneurship at Drexel. And I go around to other colleges and give presentations on why new college grads need to develop entrepreneurial mindset. And Kay had said, oh, you know, not everybody can be an entrepreneur, which is really true. Not everyone is cut out for it. But what I do is I give them some pretty depressing statistics on how the world of work has changed. Underemployment, you know, working in jobs that don't necessarily require a college degree is at an all-time high for new college grads. And I tell them the jobs that you have 10 years from now may not exist today, because with globalization and changes in technology. So I would love to hear some advice from all of you that I could give to these students. I'm trying to convince them that whether they go to work for a big company or a nonprofit, or they start something on their own, and they should try to start something on the side because they might need it to weather the changes. I think it was Tiffany that said something about the side hustle, and that's exactly the term I use. So what I'm trying to do is get them to see the world of work has changed. You're not gonna go work for a company for 20 years like your parents did, healthcare, you know, 401ks, all the things that your parents had. And so, you know, they don't always get it. So if any of you have any advice that I could give to these students as I'm going around to these different colleges, and I wanna get it into the high school level too, because they need to start thinking more entrepreneurially and what can I do to be more innovative? What do I need to do to develop these skills even if I don't want to go out and found a company like you ladies did? Thanks.
Yeah, well, I think the world of work is definitely changing. 40% of people in the year 2020, which is very fast upon us, will not be employed by major corporations. And it's the skill that you bring to the market that's really going to make the difference in the world of work as we're going forward and more people are on their own. But I'm going to quote one of our entrepreneurs, Robin Chase, who's the founder of Zipcar. And she has a book called Peers, Inc., which I think is an excellent book to understand how the at-will workforce that is self-employed and the corporations can integrate for the future world of work. So I really recommend it. It's called Peers, Inc. She was very early on in the sharing economy, of course, Zipcar back in 2000 with sharing cars. I got rid of my cars. I'm a Zipcar driver myself. She said to me when I was with her at a book event last fall, she said, let me put it this way to you. My father worked for the same company until he was 70 years old. I have worked for 7 companies in my life, and my daughter will work for 7 companies at the same time. I think it's pretty much what's happening.
Anyone else want to chime in?
I also want to say, well, a lot of you work at Google, but, you know, their code.org quoted there are, I think, 1.4 million jobs in technology that are going to be available in 2020, and only a third of those will be able to be filled by U.S. college grads. So I have 4 kids, 9 to 18 years old, and, you know, you need the technology skills. You need to be digitally, more than digitally literate. You need to know technology. You need to learn how to code. And important advice for the next generation. Don't stop out of the, join the digital revolution.
Anyone else want to chime in?
Well, about the coding thing, you know, we're really focused on STEM and in our culture now because we don't have enough people in it. But I think that coding should be taught in grade school, like the languages. If you can learn Chinese, you can learn coding in grade school, and not to be afraid of it, because everybody's not going to be a coder, everybody's not going to work in coding, but it's affecting every possible industry that you could be in, whether it's education, arts, entertainment, you know, software, transportation. I mean, architecture, you could anything is being affected by it, and you have to at least understand how it works so that you can direct people who do it for you if you're running a company or that you understand how to move in it. Mm-hmm. It's just like, as I was pointing out a moment ago about Mickey Drexler at J. Crew, who great design, great merchant, just kind of missed the whole chapter on technology and how it's changed the consumer marketing. And now in Fashion Tech Lab this year, with our class on June 14th graduating, it's, you know, we've got engineers from the Israeli Air Force using technology from the Israeli Air Force doing the mapping of topography, mountains and valleys and so forth for reconnaissance, for perhaps incursion, planes coming over the Israeli, taking that technology and applying it to people's bodies and allowing you to try things on when you're shopping online to your exact body fit. I mean, these are geek girls who are just love fashion and, you know, and they're doing some amazing things. Mickey should understand that, and every industry is going to be impacted that way. So that's.
I actually have a little bit of advice
for you to give your students, which is that it's twofold. First, as they take on multiple jobs, they should probably try to, as they figure out more and more so what industry they're looking to head into, try to figure out what are the facets of the industry that they need to know inside and out. So when I started, you know, of course, when I was thinking I need to fulfill this promise to my grandmother, and I started pursuing the media industry, I thought I need to know content, marketing, distribution, strategy, operations, finance. So I took on a job or a side hustle in every single one of these facets. That's why I worked with Vice Mayor Beijing, so because I became his global head of marketing in that initiative. With CBS, it was strategy and business development. At nights, producing feature films, it was for content development, so I could understand how to create viral content. So that there actually was a rationale behind each job. So it was figuring out the facets, and then respectively, it was encountering and emailing and becoming friends with someone in the industry that I really respected in that realm. So for example, and they actually became my first board of advisors. So in terms of finance and operations, as I was getting skill sets there, I became friends with the president of operations and finance at BBC. She's the president of overall at BBC North America. And so she became one of my advisors at Mogul on our board. And then the co-founder of Match.com became one of our advisors as well, because he knew how to scale a platform and build a product from the ground up. The chairman of Hearst Magazines became our advisor because she knew how to build a brand. And so basically every facet of the industry I was trying to develop skill sets in, I also brought on board a mentor and eventually became part of my board from doing that too.
I think we have time for one or two more questions. I can't tell if, over here?
Hi, my name is Sarah Basson. I am an accessibility evangelist here at Google. And my question comment is actually based on your last set of discussions. And that is actually this entire extremely impressive panel, and we thank you very much for being here. None of you are classically geek girls. So it sounds like, at least for the businesses and venues that you have developed, it required tech savvy, but none of you are sort of classic coders. It sounded like lots of other skills seem to go into what you have become. Coding and so on being, you needed to be savvy, you needed to understand it, you needed to leverage it, but that doesn't seem to be core. Is that correct?
It is for me.
Yeah.
It wasn't for me, actually. Coding did change my life, to be honest. If someone asks me what was my proudest accomplishment of myself, my own self, it was that I learned how to code. Because before, actually,
I might add.
Well, because when I learned all those skill sets, I mean, it was definitely positioning me in a way to be able to build up a company. But when I learned how to code, that changed everything. So definitely being a geek girl was important to starting Mogul.
And just for those of you who are not, I guess, a geek girl in this definition of it, I do think that there's like a much broader definition of geek as we're trying to expand it away from like the hoodie and the kind of like, what are they called? Tech bros. I went to architecture school. I did 5 years of structures. I did tons of like math and geometry and all that stuff. And I think anybody who starts a business has to have a certain rigor and discipline in that. And to me, like, I don't know what geek has kind of this like, or has embodied this kind of negative idea, where really like geek is just somebody who's like super disciplined, super focused, and like in it, right? Like you can geek out on anything, right? So as soon as you add geek out, and then it's like totally open. But when you say geek, it's like this really narrow word. So I think this like geek girl rising thing is actually creating like a really nice big broad umbrella for all of us to be in.
So. I like to say that geek is the new chic.
Yeah, it's I love that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. One more?
Thank you. So my name is Kathleen Camilli, and I am a geek girl rising, kind of an old one. So I'm a former Wall Street economist who pivoted my career at age 42 to do two startups, be on two public company boards of directors, and to be actively involved in the startup world. And I'm on two strategic advisory boards. I'm standing up here because I want to thank you immensely for this panel and for what you're doing in terms of going out and telling your stories. And I hope that you take it on the road and that a lot more women get to hear it, because it's very, very important. I also want to mention for the women in the room who are have young children or are thinking of having children, that there's a wonderful new school that opened here in Manhattan on the High Line 4 years ago. It's called Avenues. My son happened to be the first graduating class. It runs K through 12, and they have a STEAM curriculum, science, technology, engineering, art, and math, and they do teach coding at a very young age of age 5, and they do have an active, many startup founders of companies here in New York's children go to that school, and the kids are able to participate in a curriculum that allows them to be in the startup world. So just wanted to mention that.
Thank you so much. So before we close, I have two things I want to say. One, this event was co-hosted by Google, but also by the Harvard Business School Women's Alumni Association of Greater New York. I hope I said it right. And Lisa Leshny, who is our literary agent for Geek Girl Rising, is the co-host of this event. And unfortunately, she was ill and she was not able to join us, but she wanted us to make sure that we let you know that she's so happy that you're here and she's sorry to miss it. And now we're going to have a quick announcement from the association.
Great. Hi, I'm Lisa Goldman-Forging. I'm a board member and VP of Marketing and Membership for the HBS Women's Association of New York. So it is so great to see so many of our members here, our Google friends, and our guests. I want to thank Google and Regina, who I saw back there, and Jeremy for hosting us. Oh, there you are now. I also want to thank Lisa Leshny, who unfortunately can't be here tonight, for hosting this and inviting us to this event as well. Want to thank Jeremy and Heather for doing an amazing job on the moderating, and I want to thank Heather and Sam and Tiffany and Kay and Jean, one, for being so inspiring, and two, for sharing, being so generous in sharing your stories and insights with us. So thank you so much.